God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who might believe in him might not be condemned, but might have eternal life. I think this is probably one of the most well-known verses of scriptures, John 3:16. I haven't seen it much recently, but many years ago, like almost in every football game, there'd be someone with a sign, John 3:16. Well, this is John 3:16. So let's take a look and take a moment and look more deeper into what is the statement saying? What does it tell us? God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. Gave, what does that gave stand for? Well, it stands for suffering, pain, death on the cross, the most humiliating way of death and the most shameful way to die. That's what that gave stands for. God did not give his Son so his Son can have an enjoyable time on earth. He gave them up to die, a painful, shameful way. Why? Because God so loved the world. So it's because of the world. It's us. So let's look at this world. This world is made up of people who believe God, who love God. It's made up of people who don't even acknowledge the existence of God. It's made up of people who kind of give God lip service. Yes, I believe in God, but I don't want to have anything to do with God. I don't want God to be in my life. It's made up of people who use God's name to kill others. It's a world that's divided. There is war, there is hunger, there is poverty. Plus many other results or consequences of the selfish people who make up this world. So now putting that in perspective, God gave up his Son because he loved this world. That's horrendous. What kind of God is this God? No human parent will do what God is telling us he did. Who would sacrifice this child for somebody who doesn't even care about them? How can it this be? Is this the God that we believe in? If God did not spare his only Son, really, I'm going to trust he's going to love me and want me to have eternal life? This statement would not make sense. And shouldn't make sense. But the only way it would make sense, if God did not give up someone else, he didn't give someone else, but he gave himself. Although we refer to Jesus as the Son of the Father, but a lot of times we think like it's two different people, that God sent Jesus, kind of, he said, well, sorry, Jesus, you draw the short straw. You're going to go down and die, because I love the rest of the world more than I love you. The only way this would make sense is because what we celebrate today, that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one God. God freely offered himself to die in our place because he's a God of love. He did not give on someone else. He did not force someone else, not even ask someone else. He did it himself. That's how much God loves us. And that's what we celebrate today. You know, we've been through the acts of, you know, the life of Jesus Christ. We've been through the whole cycle from his birth to his, you know, during Lent and Easter to his death and resurrection. But all that would make sense because God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are one. And that's why the church, right after the Easter season, gives us this doctrine of Trinity, the solemnity of the Trinity. It doesn't fit in the sequential, you know, the sequential events. It's a doctrinal, you know, celebration or feast. But that's to remind us why this whole story of flood makes sense. Because we are talking about one God. One God who gave himself to us. To a world that's not necessarily going to accept him or receive his love. To a world who condemned him because he is a God of love. So the Trinity is that we have the one God, a community of three persons united by perfect love, that they are really one God. They are of the same nature, same substance, their love. Everything the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit think and act, desire, do, it's all united, perfectly united. There is no difference in their actions, their wills, their words. But we affirm it in three different ways for us to be able to understand something that really is a mystery, because how can we understand God? We can understand some things about God, we can know certain things about God, but not the fullness of who God is. So we refer to the Father as the Creator, Jesus as the Redeemer, He's the one who died for us on the cross, the Holy Spirit is the Sanctifier. But they're all of them shared in those activities. And also, you know, the Trinity, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, but you can see in the Gospel of John, who was written just 90 years, you know, 60 years after Jesus' death and resurrection, there is already this insight into how God is three persons. Through verses like this, Jesus later on talks, we heard during the Easter season, how if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. You know, I reveal the Father to you. The Father and I are one. The beginning of John, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word is God, and the Word becomes flesh. Remember, Jesus was born as a Jewish person in Jewish community that they believed in the one God. That's their kind of claim to fame from the beginning. There were the one people who God revealed to them. There is only one God. They can't suddenly say, well, yeah, there's God the Father, but then Jesus is God, and then the Holy Spirit is God, and they three different gods. And the development of the doctrine of Trinity didn't happen overnight. It took almost 300 years before we got the full understanding of the Trinity as we profess it in the act of faith, in the profession of faith. It was a slow development, but rooted in the Scripture. In the experience of the early disciples of Jesus, that yes, there is one God, a God of love, who is a community, because love is relational. You can't love if you're the only person, if you're the only God. It's got to be a relationship, and that relationship is between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. That's who God is. But as important as for us to understand who God is, because we're not there, it's important for us to know what is our own image of God. When Jesus asked the disciples, who do you say that I am? That's the other side of the same coin, the flip side of that coin. Who do we say that God is? And the best way for us to really look and understand who do we think and believe God is by looking at the way we pray. If we pray, our prayer is mostly telling God what we want, but our image of God is like Santa Claus, someone who has to give us everything we want. He's our problem solver. If our image of praying God, you know, or our way of praying God, well, no, I can't, you know, pray to God, God will never listen to me. What does that tell us? That we see God more as a judge, not as a God of love. Or every time I do something, you know, I sin, I gotta go to confession. Yeah, it's good to go to confession, but it comes to be a point sometimes where it's kind of more kind of like an addiction. But that comes with an unhealthy image that God is waiting for me to sin so He can strike me. Or when things, bad things happen to us, we blame God. But also it could be the other extreme, well, God loves me, so you know what, I don't have to do anything. God loves me, He's going to save me at the end. we can take advantage of God. So yeah, I believe in God, but I want to have a relationship with Him because He loves me. The way we pray is a good example for us, or an indication for us, on what's our image of God. And our purpose, our mission, is to move our image to God, to who truly God is, that those two images superimpose on each other and they just coincide. They just fall on top of each other, they become one image. Just think of it, if we truly believe that God is a God of love who loves me so much, when you talk with God, what do you think you should be saying to God? Will you be telling God what you want? Will you be asking God for favors or whatever, as good as they are? Or you'll be more praising God and thanking God? Because He's already given you everything. He gave you Himself. Understanding who truly God is to us helps us on our journey to become better disciples of Jesus Christ, God. Because it all comes from that image. And sometimes it's difficult. Today, unfortunately, not everyone has a good experience of having a father. And sometimes thinking of God as a father just already becomes an obstacle for us if we had a father who was abusive, or a father who abandoned us, or a father who didn't care about us, or did not express His love for us. And a lot of times we project those images on God. We create our own false God. But today's solemnity reminds us who truly God is. That really we need to have a relationship with the God who loves us so much. Why wouldn't we? Wouldn't we be seeking that? Wouldn't we be making that a priority in our lives? That we need to trust this God who loves us so much. That we need to say yes to His will in our life. That He wants only the best for us, no matter what happens. That if we follow Him, say yes to His will, and do His will in our life, one day we will be one with Him in that perfect community of love. That's the purpose of our journey in life. The way God saves us is God is willing to welcome us into that perfect community of love for all eternity. Next Sunday, we celebrate the solemnity of the body and blood of Christ, Corpus Christi. God's way to show us how we can achieve this goal, how we can receive His gift of salvation. How we can one day become members of this triune community of love of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.